Unlike Airbus, Concorde at least is more than just an outline. The shape of 21st century flight, which will cost an airline perhaps £10 million to buy. As 001 prepares for her maiden flight, 28 British plane makers have now moved to Toulouse. Concorde's being turned into a flying laboratory. Computers to record stress and reaction, 200 miles of wire. Concorde must now prove herself, and the work goes on day and night. Orders so far stand at 74, fewer than half the figure that's hoped for. But successful flight testing could change all that. Yet, at best, it's said that Concorde will recover only a third of the cost of its escalating research and development program. Is Concorde, then, a multi-million pound mistake?
I think if Concorde should fail, that we shall give up building significant aeroplanes in the future. It's a fight for survival. We are not so much now trying to make money, I think, as trying to keep in the game of competing with the Americans. I believe that Concorde potentially could make a lot of money for us. But even if it's by no means certain that it will make money for us, we should still continue with it if we want to go on building significant aircraft.
The right distance apart, yeah? About 75%. Bloody noisy in here, but what you've got...
British engineers Adrian Pollicutt and Sandy Sanderson live in Toulouse. Their commitment to Concorde is total. After British backbiting, they find the French attitude refreshing.
Concorde is a far better known thing, I feel, than in Britain. A far better known thing. Obviously here in Toulouse and in roundabout Toulouse, Concorde is extremely well known. But I found in other parts of France that a conversation with a taxi driver, the mention of the word Concorde, and there's a very fair chance that he will know what I'm talking about. He won't mistake for some other kind of agreement.
Do you mean that in Britain, if you talk to a taxi driver there, that it was conceivable that he wouldn't know what Concorde was?
I should say this was fairly certain. I know that when I go back to see my parents in Newcastle, they know what Concorde is because I'm involved in it. But friends, relatives, no, they haven't got a very informed view of Concorde if they know of it at all, if they've got any real interest in it.
How do you feel about this?
It hurts me. It hurts me a lot. I find it very difficult now to go back to Newcastle and not get involved in an argument. The general bit of knowledge that they have is that it's costing an awful lot of money. Simply that.
The figure of £500 million is bandied about.
Yeah.
This is a lot of money.
Mm-hmm. That's right. It's a lot of money. It's a lot of aeroplane as well. It's a lot of earning potential. And if we don't carry on, if Concorde was stopped, well, what do? We go and spend, in due course, a large sum of money buying aeroplanes elsewhere.
From a balance of payments point of view, if all the aircraft that Europe needs are going to be bought from America in the 1970s and 80s and thereafter, we're all going to have a chronic balance of payments problem.
Is there any possibility, Minister, of Concorde being cancelled at this stage?
If the thing were a total failure, and I don't see it, but if it were, nobody would want to go on with it. So that, looking at it, if I may, for a moment, as a minister sees it, I live with it all week in my office, and it's made in my constituency, so I live with it all weekend as well. There are two sides of this equation, and I'm sitting in the middle. There are the problems of development and production. These are technical problems, cost problems, weight growth problems, all the problems associated with going into the higher technologies. One watches these like a hawk. On the other side, there are the market problems. How many options? What about the competition? Boeing, you see, how do they stand? What about the sonic boom restrictions, if any? What about the customers? What about the selling price? What are they prepared to pay for it? Will it be profitable? And these two sides of the equation meet in only one place, in my desk. I'm spending £1 million a week on Concorde. Now, we're utterly committed to making the thing succeed. But it isn't really me who's going to decide it. It's the way these two sides of the equation work out.
With the cost of Concorde going up all the time, are you going to get your money back?
Not all of it, no. In terms of research and development, we are aiming to get, depends how the equation moves, depends how much it costs and how many we sell, about a third, perhaps, of the development costs. We are aiming to get back the full production cost, and, of course, make a big profit on the balance of payments side of it. But we recognise, I think we must, that if you're going to be in these fields, you've got to pay a price for it, and that's really why we're investing so much in Concorde.
Should the people who are involved in Concorde, in the industry, and who perhaps may be a little worried, find comfort in what you're saying?
I hope so. But let's be frank, you know, technology is absolutely inseparable from insecurity and uncertainty. I mean, if you want certainty in jobs, print newspapers. Everyone will always buy newspapers, although even those are changing. Or make some very simple product like soap. Don't get into the aircraft industry if you're really not prepared to take the rough with the smooth.
What do you think this team would do, this British design team, if Concorde were cancelled?
I think the first thing they'd do is probably burst into tears, but I don't know what they would all do, but I suspect that a lot of people, including myself, would go to Boeing's.
I wouldn't like to say that by not taking the opportunities for the 1970s, we'll miss out completely, but it would be tragic if we did, because we are at a crest at the moment. We are in a very good position in terms of world commercial aviation, and it would be a thoroughgoing tragedy if we didn't build on that present success.